today we're going to talk about controlling CO2. From what I've said, it's very clear that carbon dioxide is rising in a geologic sense really fast, faster than any other record we have. It's impacted the weather, the climate, sea level, and last week we talked about how it impacts food. And it's going to have a big impact on food. I think I ended with saying that one estimate is that 50% of the increase in food in the future, food price in the future, will be a result of climate change effects. And today, we're going to talk about trying to control it, because it's the warming that's causing all the problems that we see. Carbon dioxide is up there, we can't see it, we can't smell it, we can't taste it. So it's not really recognizable by us, but it is up there, and it is trapping heat, and it's global warming that's the problem. I think maybe I might have mentioned, it's worth re-mentioning, that you produce a lot of it. A pound of carbon dioxide per mile in your car, if your car gets 20 miles per gallon, that's a lot. Ask yourself, how long does it take to put my weight of carbon dioxide up into the atmosphere? How many miles do you have to drive? Another kind of factoid that's handy to keep in mind is that that lump of carbon dioxide as gas, when it's in the atmosphere and during its lifetime there, will trap 10,000 times as much heat, infrared heat, as was liberated when it moved your car down the road a mile. So that's a tremendous amount of heat. It changes the radiation budget of the globe, and that's what its effect is. And right now it's changed it enough so that it's about 1 to 1.5 watts per meter square. To give you an idea what that might mean, a meter square is about a yard square, and that 1 to 1.5 watts is one of those little white Christmas lights that you see people like to put all over their trees. That's about a watt. And in the future, when we get to 2 degrees centigrade of global warming, it will be about 2.5 watts, maybe 3. So it's not very much. That's one of the paradoxes of the whole thing, that small amount of energy is having this huge impact on our climate. So the thing we have to do is we somehow have to regulate carbon dioxide. Because if we don't, if we allow the CO2 to rise as it's rising at the moment, it's likely to increase the global temperature about 5 degrees this century. That's a possibility. It's not a strong possibility, but it's a possibility. 5 degrees is about the temperature change that the Earth underwent from the last glacial maximum until basically now, basically the middle of the 19th century, when we presumably started doing all this. Although, as you recall, one guy said it was back to the beginning of agriculture, and I can think of a mechanism and showed you how that might have happened. So today, we're going to talk about controlling carbon dioxide. So the first thing is, the Paris Agreement and the IPCC, over the years, have decided that 2 degrees centigrade is just about the maximum we could tolerate without what James Hansen calls catastrophic changes to the Earth. And that can only be done if we can figure out how to conserve energy so that the rate at which we put CO2 up there decreases. Now, that won't change the ultimate temperature if we don't do anything else. So if we increase renewables and reduce coal, we can really depress the amount of carbon dioxide we put up there. And I'm going to talk about what those mean today. But we really can make progress if we can figure out how to remove carbon dioxide from burning fossil fuel. And we have a mechanism for doing that. It's called carbon capture and sequestration. And best of all, if we could figure out how to remove CO2 from the atmosphere, we could still use fossil fuels by taking it out of burning fossil fuels, say in electricity production. And if we could take it out of the atmosphere, we would take the cause of the warming away and still keep the energy, because we're not going to stop using energy. We will continue to use energy no matter what. I don't know how bad the hurt is going to be before we consider changing energy altogether to something like fusion, which has always been about 30, 40 years in the future, and may always be. Anyway, so how far have we got to go before 2 degrees centigrade? Well, somebody put together this interesting figure. If you don't mind, I'm going to turn that down a little bit. This tells us in 2015, we used up almost 3/4 of the amount of carbon we can take out of the ground, burn, and put the carbon dioxide up in the atmosphere. Now, there are some disagreements about how much this is, but not very much. We are testing the limits of how far we can go until we put too much CO2 into the atmosphere. Okay, so we'll let it go one more time, and that we haven't quite reached 1.5 degrees yet. We're getting there. All right, so we're going to talk first about, I heard somebody say today, 45 gigatons doesn't mean anything to me. It doesn't mean anything to me either. To give you a sense of what a gigaton is all of the carbon in the forests and soils of New Hampshire and Vermont. So if you could capture all the carbon in the forests and soils of New Hampshire and Vermont, that would be 1 gigaton. It's a huge number. We put up carbon dioxide in America at the rate of about 20 tons per year. Here's 20 tons of carbon dioxide, and there we are up at the top. We like to be number one, and we still are. Now, cultures that are different from ours consume less energy, and on a per capita basis, for example, there's China way down there, but because there's so many more Chinese than there are Americans, the total amount of carbon dioxide put up is now by China. But China knows that and is paying very close attention and is managing to change their structure of energy consumption. And it's having an economic effect because they burn a lot of coal, they have coal of their own. I'm standing here looking at a man from China, a visiting scholar, and he's nodding his head. But a culture that's very much like ours is France. And they produce only about a third of the amount of carbon dioxide that we do. So how do they do that? Well, they do it by burning nuclear, by creating their electricity with nuclear. Nuclear has had a bad reputation, and it comes and goes. We'll speak about nuclear in a little bit. Here in the US, each of us produces enough carbon dioxide, on average, to equal the weight of 4 African elephants per year. That's 20 tons, each African elephant weighing about 5 tons. That carbon dioxide would fill 2 of these large blimps. Now maybe that gets the scale down to where you can get an appreciation for it. So tons of carbon dioxide. What can we do in a personal basis about this? How could we affect a change in our profligate production of carbon dioxide? I don't say use of energy, I say production of carbon dioxide. Well, we take this number, 80 tons, that's for a family of 4, and we divide it up into blimps. So here are 2 blimps, that's for 1 person. But that is a household energy. Over here is household energy, it's that color. So these 2 blimps. 2.25 blimps for transportation. And all of the rest, 50%, is what we'll call industrial. It's all of the CO2 produced by all of the energy processes that are carried out so that we can live the standard of living that we do. We have to build roads. We have to have schools, we have to have all kinds of stuff. And making the stuff and making all of that other stuff requires energy, and that's where the other 50% comes from. So we're not going to be able to do much about this, and after we talk about a little about this, we'll get to that. So first of all, how much can you reduce your CO2 footprint? You can replace electric water heaters with solar water heaters, and you can replace your lights with LED. Now, this is easy. because it's what you call low-hanging fruit, because thermal solar heaters are common in China, very common. Here, less so, but they are here, and there are places that use them. Well, if you did all of that, you could reduce your footprint by about 5%. Doesn't seem like very much. And it's a little bit expensive. LEDs are not cheap. What about transportation? Well, the Chevy Volt, there's one out in the parking lot. I know because I put it there. The Chevy Volt is basically an electric car. It's called a plug-in hybrid because it has a gasoline engine that basically charges the battery, and when the battery runs out, helps to run the car. But you can get in, you can get 50 miles on the battery, 50 miles plus, but they say, they sell the car by saying you can get 50 miles on the battery and an extra 280 miles on 9 gallons of fuel in the tank. Now, I've owned the Chevy Volt since before Christmas and driven it 3,000 miles, very close to 3,000 miles. I visited the gas station twice, and I think I've burned about 10 gallons of fuel in 3,000 miles. The rest of it is plugging it in and charging it up. So when I go to Whole Foods to buy some groceries, I can plug it in there if there's nobody using the one station that they have. They have two stations. They have one station with two outlets. So you can plug your Chevy Volt in and will charge while you're shopping. Chevy is also producing a Bolt. This is kind of tricky. Mark Twain said, words are very important. It's important to know the difference between lightning bug and lightning bolt. But the Chevy Bolt will go over 200 miles. In fact, it'll go farther than the Tesla, the new Tesla 3 or something that's coming out to compete with it. It's about the same price. And you get a rebate of about $7,500. The cost of running this from our home is about $40 a month. So I calculate cost for fuel for this car, about $50 a month, probably $10 for the gas and the rest for the electricity. But when you go into town, into DC now, there are a lot of charging stations and it's basically pennies to charge. So the electricity is something like a quarter or 20% of the cost of gasoline. When gasoline goes up, it gets better. So that's the Chevy, and that's electric cars, and there are many of them, hardly a car company that's not producing them. So if you have such a car, you can really make a big difference. You can change your carbon footprint by about 15%, but you can change the cost of operating a car a lot more. Now, the take-home lesson from this is that we will switch to low carbon technology when we can afford it. We could also afford to put photovoltaic cells on our roof and use the energy to run our homes. Of course, the complaint is that the sun doesn't always shine, and that's true, but Elon Musk has thought of that, and he's now producing home batteries that cost about $3,500 that you can charge with your solar cells, and it will run your house for 24 hours, the average house. So things are happening, and we are getting more and more technology to help us to reduce carbon dioxide. So what about the 50% of electricity generation? What can we do there? Well, wind, solar, and biofuels are available, not only for just electricity, but for cars as well. There is nuclear, and there is CO2 capture and sequestration. So if we could engage all of those right now, we could make a total reduction in our carbon dioxide footprint of about 60%. I wouldn't take too seriously that number because you can very quickly get into an argument about how that could happen and how much one thing means to another. And those of you who are engineers in the room would have a field day with all of this. But the point is, you can really make a difference at your home. But the big difference has to come from changes that we make in a kind of a structural way. And so this problem is not, in essence, really a problem for home correction. This is a problem for local and national policymakers. And by the local policymakers are doing much better than the national policymakers so far. And different governments differ on how they do this. So the sources of carbon dioxide are from coal plants, from surface transportation, they're roughly equal, from industrial and other processes. Here's aviation down here. You always have to have liquid fuels, as near as I can tell, with aviation, although they have produced a few gliders with batteries in them to take off and land, and some small airplane planes they're experimenting with. But batteries now weigh so much that it's not practical for transportation, air transportation. But coal is the target. More CO2 is emitted from coal-fired electric generation plants than from any other technology or sector, including all modes of surface transportation combined. So coal is the target. And coal is suffering. These dots represent electricity producing coal-fired power plants that have been retired between 2012 and 2016. And coal-fired electricity production decline in 2016 is the largest annual decline in tons and percentages since 1949. So coal is feeling the trouble here. Yes.
That's only true in the United States, though, isn't it?
Yes. That's only true in the United States, and in worldwide, it's not quite clear whether coal is still it's still the main source, and it's not clear whether it's increasing. In Australia, for example, in fact, you can go on YouTube and see this big discussion about coal in Australia, and it's fascinating because the coal is Australia's really big export. Wheat is the other one, and their buyers are China and India. China has said they're not going to import any more coal. They're going to use their own, and then they're going to switch to nuclear, wind and solar, and so forth. And I'm getting confirmation here from our from our friend. And us. Yes, question.
So people use the term clean coal. Is there such a thing?
It's hard to imagine. It could. In principle, you could take everything out of coal and just, but it's not being done. And there are now signs that it's going in the opposite direction. This panel shows the decline in jobs in the coal industry in these two states, in Kentucky and West Virginia. This decline has gone on for a long time, starting way back with Reagan, Bush, Clinton, and so forth. And it's not clear how that's going to turn around, because the problem is not the willingness of people to go into the mine and dig up the coal. The problem is that once they've got it out, they can't sell it. And so the big question has become, what's driving the decline in coal in the United States? And the answer is natural gas, the falling cost of wind and solar, and environmental regulations. Well, something is being done about environmental regulations, right, as we speak. The increase in wind and solar, though, is having a huge impact, and you can see why. If you use coal to produce electricity, there's the constant demand to produce it, and there is the constant pressure on the price of it. And so that's always out there. If you buy enough solar panels to produce the electricity you need, and if there are enough wind farms to pick up the load where it's needed, there is some possibility that you could regulate the price of it. But with coal, probably not. So here are the sources of energy for producing electricity. The three biggies are nuclear, coal, and gas. 30% of all US electricity from wind and solar by 2030. That's a goal. In Maryland, there's a bill, and I think it passed the legislature, I should know, maybe George can tell me, that says 25% of renewable energy, and it includes wind and solar, but also biomass, by 2025. That was a change in an earlier bill. And there was another bill before the legislature or about to be, for an enormous wind farm off the coast of Maryland. So Maryland recognizes the value of moving in that direction, and is. But I've also heard that if you look at all of this rapid increase in use of wind and solar, it's projected that by 2050, there could be 80% of electricity produced by wind and solar. But keep in mind that electricity is not the total source of carbon dioxide. It's one part of it. It's about a third of it. Okay, so I want to speak for a moment about nuclear. Nuclear has the smallest carbon footprint. Well, I'll take that back. Not quite the smallest. I used to say this, but I discovered a study that was made, and there are one or two others that are smaller. Hydropower, for example, and wind. They have both a smaller carbon footprint. The reason nuclear has a footprint at all is because of the terrific cost of building a nuclear power plant. But once you've got it, then you've got something that will last 40, 50 years. The life of them is being extended. We have about 100 in the United States, 400 worldwide, but folks are ramping it up. China, for example, is building more nuclear power plants. So the number of power plants could grow, but it's very contentious. In Europe, Germany is closing their nuclear power plants and buying the electricity from France, which is keeping theirs. I'm not sure about the logic there, but there are strange ideas around nuclear. And I want to just present something I call the nuclear symmetry, which kind of captures the whole story. Nuclear is clean because it doesn't produce any carbon dioxide. But others say it's really dirty because of the waste and because of the mining. Safe? Well, as far as we know, there have been no deaths in the United States from nuclear power, and the record worldwide is remarkable. People argue about what has happened in Chernobyl and in Fukushima. Three Mile Island nearly was a meltdown. In fact, people were sure it was because at the same time that it happened, a new film had been produced called The China Syndrome with Jack Lemmon in it. The China Syndrome means that the thing melts down, goes all the way through the earth, and comes out at China. We always thought that, but that's not really where it comes out if it goes straight through the earth. Maybe it comes out in Australia, which somebody pointed out. We haven't attacked Australia lately. Maybe that. Anyway, is it safe? Zero deaths. The Navy runs nuclear power plants in all their ships, and many of their ships. And if you follow the rules the Navy does, after Three Mile Island, the nuclear industry began to be more accountable. So from that respect, it's safe, but it's bloody dangerous. It is, I said, Three Mile Island and Chernobyl. There is an interesting film about this. It's called Pandora's Paradox. And it's a film, I think, created on the back of a couple of books about nuclear. One was by Gwyneth Cravens, a book called Power to Save the World. She had been an activist and helped close down the big nuclear plant on Long Island that got built and then was sold for a dollar and never actually operated. But her father had a friend who was in the nuclear industry, and he told her that she had not understood what nuclear is about. He had been in charge of the safety in the laboratories, the nuclear labs in the United States, especially one in Idaho, which was built to test various nuclear facilities for their safety. He got her into all of these, and then she ended up writing a book about it. That book, plus others, inspired this film, and it's on Netflix, and you can see it, Pandora's Paradox. Weapons from the products of this are probably the most scary aspect of getting it in the wrong hands. The evidence is that difficulty we had in getting an agreement from Iran not to produce any, and the scary business with North Korea is still out there. But there are others, Pakistan. It's cheap. The fuel is cheap. It's remarkable how little fuel it actually uses, and the ones we currently use don't use very much of it, a small percentage of it. And the newer ones will use recycle that fuel and use a lot more of it. The bad news is that that process also produces plutonium. Costly to build and maintain. And this is probably the one right now that prevents a rapid expansion of nuclear. But if we're really serious about controlling carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, nuclear energy looks like it has to be part of the mix. But what about wind, solar, and biofuels? These have been, the price of wind and solar has been coming down terrifically. This is from Bloomberg. And this red line here shows the decline in prices since 1975 down to 2015, and last year it went down further. The cost of these things is getting cheap because of the scale of production. China is producing enormous amounts of these, but also of the advances in technology. The efficiency of these things is somewhere in the vicinity of 15% to 20% at maximum. Mostly it's less than that. But I was watching a lecture from Stanford University of a group that's working on efficiencies. And they recently got the efficiencies of printable solar panels. Printable. Now, instead of using crystals, silicon crystals, which is what most of them were made out of earlier, they now have a process and a compound that they can print on plastic. So you could inexpensively print and just turn these loose. Another reason is that a whole cadre of installations and installers has been trained over the past 10, 15 years. And so they're getting better at it. It's getting cheaper to install. So solar is more and more valuable. One interesting fact is that in the United States, in the continental United States, no place is the total energy from solar in an annual basis less than half of the maximum you might find in New Mexico or Arizona. Now that's an interesting thing, because it means that there is plenty of it out there. So solar is coming down, and the number of installations is increasing, and it's ramping up very quickly. And here is something from the Union of Concerned Scientists. These numbers over here represent the wind and solar power provided by for electricity in these states. This one is Oregon, Idaho, Colorado, Minnesota, North Dakota, and up here is Iowa, wind and solar. 15% in Germany, nearly 20 in Spain, and 30 in Denmark, with huge numbers of wind fields. What about the other thing that we saw in this picture, the bio of the biofuels? Well, in the United States, we produce a lot of biofuel, but most of it is from corn. That's called maize here. That's what they call it everywhere else in the world except here. A few others are involved there. The problem with it is that when you grow a crop of corn, you can grab carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, and this is the main justification for doing it. But then, to produce ethanol and run it back in your car, you return all that carbon dioxide back into the atmosphere, because producing ethanol is not a very efficient process. There are plants, however. This is miscanthus. This is Miss Heaton. Miss Heaton was a graduate student at the University of Illinois, worked with a close associate, and they experimented with this plant that is a native of Europe, and for years has been used for various things you can use plants for, especially for biofuel. And this one could be used for biofuel. It has many advantages. It is efficient with water. It's very efficient with nitrogen. Two facts that limit plant growth in the Midwest and everywhere else. But you can see the size of it. it dries in the field, so you don't have to spend a lot of money on drying it before you could burn it. So what would you do with it? Well, this little cartoon gives an example of two ways that you could use this plant to produce a fuel to drive a car. You can harvest it, and then you can either take it to an ethanol refinery where you have got to digest the cellulose that's in the cell walls and turn that into sugars that can then be fermented and get the ethanol out of that. Alternatively, you can dump it into an electricity generator and simply burn it, to use it to produce heat, turn the turbine over, make electricity, and then run it in your car. And if you do it that way, with the ethanol, you can get about 8,000 miles per acre in your little car like mine. But if you burn it and make electricity, you can get about twice as many miles out of it. So there are efficiencies of the way these things can be done that are much, much better than taking land out of production for food and turning it into a fuel which you can only add to gasoline and probably doesn't do very much for you. Thermodynamically, it goes nowhere. But this might be a way to use land that's not possible to use for plant production, for food, rather just use it for electricity. And biofuels are used around the world, not all of them for making ethanol. Most of them, in fact, are used to burn. In fact, Maryland buys electricity from Virginia, which cuts down trees and burns it to produce electricity. So biofuel is out there if you consider the broadest sense. So the sources of U.S. electricity, again, are nuclear, coal, and gas. And in those, you could conceivably take the gas that is produced when you're making the electricity and remove the carbon dioxide from it. Now, chemically, and at least from the perspective of a laboratory bench, this is nothing new. The oil and gas industry have been doing this for a very long time. They capture carbon dioxide in various ways, and then they pump it back down into oil wells to drive more oil out. They claim it makes the oil cleaner, and they can thereby harvest more oil. So the basic procedure is understood. The problem is the scale. Now, the concept here is that you would produce electricity in a big plant, and then you capture the gas that's coming off the burner, and you separate the carbon dioxide from it. Once you've got the carbon dioxide...
What efficiency are you suggesting?
I'll show you in just a moment. See what I mean? You find an engineer, you get into an argument about practically any aspect of this. Let's stay with the cartoon for just a moment. The point of this is you can capture the carbon dioxide and you can pump it back underground. Now, these yellow numbers here tell you in gigatons the capacity we might have here in the United States for depleted oil reservoirs, deep saline aquifers, unminable coal beds. I don't know how the CO2 attaches itself to coal, but apparently it does. And I keep seeing stories about folks in different parts of the world figuring out what kind of rock is below ground and what will absorb carbon dioxide. Another more interesting one is pumping it into the ocean with the hope that it will stay there. And I guess wouldn't be much point in putting it out there if it wouldn't stay there. So you have to capture it, you have to build pipelines. The miles of pipelines that you would have to build are enormous. But this is essentially doable. Now, if we get to the point where we have to have energy from coal or gas, this could possibly be done. But it's not being done at scale except for one place, and I'll show you in a moment. Now, as to the efficiency of it, this is from the one plant that is doing this now, that you can capture about 90% of the CO2 that's coming out. Now that's a really big thing. And of course you're immediately going to ask, what's the cost? And the cost varies depending upon how far you have to pump it. If things are close, if you're close to a place where You can put it back underground. It's less than if you have to pump it a long way. But the cost turns out to be somewhere between $10 and $60 a ton. Now remember, there are only one or two places that have done this at scale, and the scale matters. So here is the one place that is online and working. We have one funded in the United States, but it's not online yet. It's in Louisiana. And this one is in Canada. You can go there, saskpower.com. And their website gives you a sort of an introduction to how they do it and what they're doing. So that's carbon capture and sequestration. Now there's another modification of this that's quite interesting. It's called biomass energy with carbon capture and storage. Remember in the cartoon, burning the miscanthus in the burner and running the car 15,000 miles on the electricity. Well, if you could capture the carbon dioxide from that process and put it back underground, you now have a trap for carbon dioxide, namely green plants. How effective this will be is not clear, because plants are not, by industrial processes, a very efficient capture of carbon dioxide. Nevertheless, it's out there, and to the extent that we're using plants for biofuel, for electricity, this modification would satisfy the demand to get something, some system to take carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. I'm going to just summarize the way we might consider all of this with another couple of cartoons. First, the panel over there shows what happens when we catch, we take fossil fuel out of the ground and burn it in a burner and use the atmosphere as the dumping ground. That's basically the procedure. That's for fossil fuel. Now for carbon capture and sequestration, we do the same thing, except that we capture some of the carbon, you know, as much as 90%, and put it back underground. With biomass to the atmosphere, we burn the plants, the CO2 goes back up into the atmosphere, some more plants replace the ones that were there. It takes a while, in terms of a forest, 30, 40 years. But that is a procedure where we don't have to take fossil fuel out of the ground, but as I said, the scale of this is not very big. And finally, bioenergy with carbon capture and sequestration imagines taking CO2 from the atmosphere by plants, running it through a device to convert to electricity, and back underground. So conceptually, at least, we can see a way forward with biomass energy and carbon capture and sequestration. Now this is basically the last slide of the talk. I got a little bit more, but I want to bring you back to this, because when we say we can use, for example, biomass energy with carbon capture and sequestration, that still leaves an awful lot of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and other processes that we haven't dealt with. And we have to find some way to remove CO2 from the atmosphere if we're going to keep the temperature under control, because there is a linear relationship between the load of CO2 in the atmosphere and the temperature. And it doesn't matter how long it takes you to put the CO2 up there. If you keep putting it up there, the temperature is going to keep going up. And as I said, we're faced with the iron law of the willingness to use energy over the need to somehow control carbon dioxide. Well, the next lecture is going to talk about skepticism to denial and some thoughts from Naomi Oreskes from her book, Merchants of Doubt. So with that, I would like to stop and see if you have any questions, and better still, what's the chance I can answer them? Thank you. Let me just turn the light on.